So I'm talking about the disparity that's happened in the offices around town, throughout the music industry. I'm about to introduce you to a couple of ladies that are going to talk about the next step. What does the public see? What do the creatives feel? What do the artists feel? Is it the same on the airwaves? Not quite. So they're going to address that. So with that, please welcome Tracy Gershon, VP of A&R at Rounder Records and manager at Red Light Management, along with Leslie Fram, Senior VP of Music Strategy for Viacom and CMT.
We thought it said women who should be in rocking chairs, and then we asked for stools.
First of all, thank you guys so much. We actually really feel honored to be sharing this stage with so many incredible women. And we love Heather McBee and we love Beverly Keel, who's part of Change the Conversation. So thank you all for being here.
Yes, and thanks to Tom Truitt and the team at Who Knew. I know it took a lot to put this together. Leslie and I are very close friends, and we have so much in common. And we like to have a lot of fun. We decided we wanted to have fun with this. And so rather than talk about ourselves, we're going to talk about each other.
Yes.
You know,
that sound good?
That's what women should do anyway, is really support and talk about each other.
Let me talk a little bit about this woman, Tracy Gershon, who's such a rock star. We've become like sister wives. We met here 3 years ago and have this kindred spirit. But the reason I have notes is because she has had the most amazing, multifaceted career, seriously. She's been doing this for 30 years, and I kind of want to go through some of the highlights for you guys because I'm not sure you realize how many things that she's done and how many things that she's done successfully. One thing I just found out is that she first started as a booking agent. She was booking concerts at UC Santa Monica or Santa Barbara, and Billboard magazine gave her an award, College Buyer of the Year. I'm just wondering, like, does Brian O'Connell or Ali Harnell know about this? I mean, you're a concert promoter.
They feel very safe.
She moved to Nashville in 1989 with her amazing husband, Steve, who's in the audience. She was A&R at EMI Publishing. She has an amazing publishing background. She also has a reputation for really developing and nurturing artists, which you will see in the next few minutes. She headed up Creative, the department in Nashville publishing companies like Warner Chappell, Sony Music. She was also an A&R rep at Warner Brothers Music and Sony Records. So let me just go through some of the artists. And she signed a lot of artists, and I can't mention all of them, but I would like to highlight a few because I feel like she took a risk here. At Sony Publishing, Tracy signed the Mavericks, which at a time was a little left of center in the country field. She signed Kacey Musgraves to her first publishing deal at Warner Chappell. Amazing. At Sony Music, she was a judge for Nashville Star. I wish I had been in town during that time period, but that's where she discovered and signed Miranda Lambert. I mean, pretty amazing. Right now, Tracy is a manager at Red Light. She has a bunch of roles. I was going to say dual, but it's actually triple. She's a manager at Red Light. She manages an amazing female country artist named Natalie Stovall, who has an incredible voice.
Note the slide.
She's one of CMT's Next Women of Country. She's head of A&R at Rounder Records. You guys know Rounder is a legendary label. They have artists like Alison Krauss. And since Tracy has been at Rounder, she's signed really a variety of artists. Everyone from Blackberry Smoke, Honey Honey, Jack Ingram, Trigger Hippie, and most recently, Sean O'Connell, who I absolutely love. And I was going to stop there, but I was reminded that she is also an adjunct professor at the University of New Haven at Blackbird Academy.
And my students are all supposed to be here.
Are the students here?
Are students here?
Better be here.
This is my class night, by the way. This is their class.
And I have to read a quote from producer Paul Worley that to me really sums up Tracy as a creative person. Quote, I met a person who had great instincts, song sense, grit, energy, and the tenacity to be a great A&R person. And that to me sums it up. One of the things that I feel rings true throughout your career, Tracy, is that you are a risk taker. You follow your gut, and you really nurture artists. And I'd love for you to give us some examples of some of the risks that you took along the way.
First of all, like that quote from Paul. Paul was a mentor for me, and I think mentors are so important, whether they're women or men, and we all need to mentor because that, you know, like I said, he did a lot for me. I think when we talk about risk and we talk about, you know, when you talk about the things I signed, there was a lot that I signed that has never seen the light of day. I still think it's great, but I will say that I don't regret any of it because without taking risk, you can't win. You know, you have to make a home run, you got to be up at bat. And so it's okay. And the fear of failure is an okay thing. So, you know, one of the things we were talking about this that's not in my bio and I think was an early risk was when I first started falling in love with country music. And this is, like I said, I should be in the rocking chair 25, 30 years ago. I met a young artist named Rosie Flores who asked me to be her manager, and I had no idea what a manager was, and I said yes. And my first thing as her manager was to find money to fund a demo. My husband was producing, we had no money, and so what did I do? I went on a game show. I clapped and stood up and down like an idiot and won $1,400 and some luggage, and we sent it, and we got her a deal at Warner Brothers.
And that was like way before Pledge Music or anything, so...
It's like one of those little-known facts, but it really did teach me about thinking outside the box and being, you know, just not saying no and just finding ways to do things. We want to keep this short, but another act that I'm really proud of that was taking a risk was the Mavericks, because when I signed them, it was at a time when, you know, they were not mainstream country. They were not something like that was not being played on the radio, and I really just felt that they were great and had a place. And I didn't know if they would be successful. Because I was passionate about it, and again, was not scared to fail. And I had good people around me, Donna Hilly at Sony Tree and Paul Worley, who believed in me and said, go. I mean, if I, you know, 10 times, you know, failure, they probably wouldn't have said go, but I was very fortunate. And again, I remember thinking the stuff that I'm really passionate about and I really feel has a place, I'm just going to go for. And so that was a...
Can you just mention quickly, like Miranda and Casey, how that came about?
Casey was somebody I'd seen on Nashville Star earlier. And when I first got to Warner Chappell, she was the first person I signed, and I signed her because she had such an amazing point of view, and I just felt there was an artist in there, and I just loved what she did. I'd say signing Miranda wasn't a risk. Going on Nashville Star was more of a risk, because I literally felt like I was going to ruin my career. It was kind of seemed like the stupidest thing in the world to do, and luckily I had somebody very close, an artist, and I called her, and I was almost crying on the phone, and she said, you know what, go bring integrity to it, go do what you do and make it better. And so I went and said okay. But Miranda was just one of these artists I saw in Houston. I just called the head of the label at the time and said, I don't know if she'll make it on the show, but we have to sign this woman. And I think that she has been to me the ultimate artist. She just changes herself. She just stays true to who she is, and she's a true artist. And also, we'll talk about this later, supports women like nobody's business. She is really
amazing.
Supports other women.
Amazing.
So, yes, you know, I feel like we're doing an SNL skit, right?
I know.
We're like the Bobbsey twins up here. And now, Leslie, you're live. So, Leslie Fram, as you know, is at CMT. And I, as far as, you know, you cannot walk down the street and throw a rock and hit somebody without them saying, oh, my God, Leslie Fram, she helped me in so many ways. She is the most passionate person about music I've ever met and passionate about helping people. And she has brought that passion to CMT. She she is in charge of all strategies, music strategies across their platforms. And I think she does a lot. But the thing that I think is amazing and she's probably most proud of is that she is behind and is the genius behind the CMT's Next Women of Country. And this is in its third year. And Next Women of Country has given up-and-coming artists a platform where they didn't have one. Women who weren't, whether or not they had deals, whether or not they were being played on the radio. And she has really promoted the artists like a Brandi Clark when nobody else was doing that. And I mean, it's really been a helpful and great thing, and you should be so proud. I know that we are all so proud of her. You may not know this about Leslie, but she had a huge career in radio. She was a programmer for Top 40 and Alternative in Atlanta, New York, Alabama, and she was the program director at a groundbreaking station in Atlanta called 99X. And I think that, yeah, I mean, you, And I think the reason it was so groundbreaking, because they broke a lot of new artists and took risks, was probably because Leslie Fram was there. And so I'm going to turn it back to you, Leslie. What were some of the things and risks that you took early on that, you know, you can talk about?
Well, I think you have to, you know, also go back to who you worked for. And if you're at a place where you have those opportunities to take risks, and not everyone can do that. But, you know, at the time in the early 90s, you know, alternative radio wasn't a successful format. But we sort of wrote down what we thought this would look like, and they actually let us do it. But I feel that if someone is signed or unsigned, it doesn't matter. It's about how great they are and how great the music is. So what we would do in radio in Atlanta to really create artists in Atlanta and make them famous in Atlanta, we didn't really look at national charts, is that if the song was amazing and it was a local band, we would play it. If the song was amazing and it was an artist on Warner Brothers Records, we would play it. So a lot of artists got their start in Atlanta, and they still have a successful touring career in Atlanta. And some of those artists were people like, Tracy knows, Sean Mullins, who she just signed. Sean was a local artist who'd been beating the ground forever, selling CDs out of the trunk of his car. And he came in one day and played us just some amazing music. And there was this one song called Lullaby. And that was when in radio you could just walk right into the control room and have the DJ play the song. And the phones went nuclear. And we added the record. And, you know, the next day he had like five or six labels calling him. And to this day, I mean, he's an amazing songwriter. He has a great career. So we were able to do that for people. Mm-hmm. You know, even people like Dave Cobb, who's an amazing producer, he had a band called the Tender Idols that we used to play. Right. So I feel that, again, it doesn't really, that's how my philosophy about artists just in general now, too. When I got to Nashville, I didn't know a lot about contemporary country music, but I went to the Bluebird one night, which is what you do when you move to Nashville, and there was this amazing songwriter round with this guy named Shane McAnally and this woman named Brandy Clark. I didn't know who they were. I fell in love with Brandy, and I sort of like tracked her down and had lunch with her and said, you know, what are you doing? Do you want to be an artist? And she said, I do. And I said, well, it doesn't cost that much really to make a video. Why don't you make a video and we'll play it? So she hired Becky Fluke, who's an amazing photographer, videographer. They made this video for under $10,000, and it was for the song called Stripes, and we played it for 7 months.
That's great.
And I feel like this is her year.
Yes, because of you, partly because of you. I'm looking at that timer going, and one of the reasons we're together is because we did want to talk about, I'm not ignoring you, change the conversation. As Beverly mentioned earlier, Beverly Keel, myself, and Leslie Fram all got together a year and a half ago to start something called Change the Conversation that we're very proud of. It really started because there is a perception, there's a perception and a vicious cycle about that women, A, don't want to hear other women played on the radio. Record labels were hesitant to sign a lot of women because they thought that that radio wouldn't play those women, and then radio would complain and say they weren't getting enough women from record labels, and it was this cycle. And we were all so frustrated. She had she was doing Next Women of Country. I was always trying to sign women artists and songwriters, and I always got this, well, there's one slot, which didn't make a sense. Beverly was talking about the lack of women on country radio. We got together and decided we were going to do something positive, not whine, something positive to change this perception and break the cycle.
And we really did want to change the conversation, and it started out really organically at Beverly Keel's house, and then it just grew from there, where we wanted to have events where we had powerful speakers talk about what can we do. We were at CAA, where the branding department talked about how females were so huge with brands, then why aren't they getting played on the radio? We went to a record label and had the radio promotion person talk about what's it like to work females at radio. We were here at Third and Lindsley, where we had some concert promoters and club owners talk about booking female artists. Do they sell beer? Do they not sell beer? So it really is something that has become a movement, and we're proud of it. And we now want to announce to you guys our very first mentoring session that we're doing in just a few weeks.
Right. And just before that, one other note is one of the things that we have really strived to do, and I think we have, is to build a community among these young artists, because, you know, they were told that there was one slot for so long, and it really made them competitive with each other. And now we're seeing everybody supporting, and we've really encouraged it. And I will say that I think we've made a difference. There's more women being signed. There's more women breaking through. And I really feel like we have a lot of work to do, but we keep doing it. Our mentorship program, and sorry we're going fast because we're almost out of time, but we decided out of this we had to have a mentorship program in a more formal way. I know Leslie, Beverly, myself all do it kind of organically, but at the Bluebird Cafe on March 29th, we will have our first kind of up-and-coming artist mentor, and Reba McEntire will be our first, you know, guest host who will talk to the young artists and do a Q&A. You can go to the Change the Conversations, it's plural, I couldn't get Change the Conversation, our Facebook page, and look and get some details coming up. But please go up and sign them and go to our page and start. Look, we're going to have some more events in the next year. It's growing. It's an important cause. And we are not going to stop until we no longer have to have this conversation. That's our goal.
Thank you guys so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. All right, if you can talk really loud, we've got time for one question for these ladies before they leave the stage. Anyone? You got to shout it and shout it loud.
Here we go.
Oh.
The best piece of advice you ever got.
Ooh.
I got so much advice. I think just to be, you know, again, let my passion drive me. And don't take no for an answer is really the best advice I got. Just don't stop at no, keep going.
I think mine would be know yourself. I was in an event last night, and that's their theme, is to know yourself. But honestly, is to work off people's strengths. That is the greatest thing that you can do.
Awesome. Thank you.
Inside, time for a solution. Changes in the